It's an all-out battle for Congress. Today, the Wisconsin Democratic congressman at the top of the GOP hit list and his Republican challenger. That's next on Upfront.
I'm a hard worker. I'm honest. I'm someone who can't be bought. So in this district, that's a pretty good moniker to have.
I really do believe that there's an enthusiasm gap right now, and it's in our favor. And so I'm looking very much forward to November 2nd.
Then, the final face-off in the race for U.S. Senate. Is this race getting tighter in its last days? And the bills come due for the president's rally in Madison. How much Democrats will have to pay up? It's all this week on Upfront.
Honest, candid, insightful. This is Upfront with Mike Gousha.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome to Upfront. To say it's a challenging year to be a Democrat might be an understatement. Capitol Hill observers say there are now 90 Democratic-held seats in the House with the potential to change hands. Republicans only need to win 39 of them to gain control of the House. Several of those seats, the contested ones, are right here in Wisconsin. The 8th Congressional District race in northeast Wisconsin has Democratic incumbent Steve Kagen trying to fend off a challenge from Republican Reid Ribble. Kagen, a doctor from Appleton, has been a top GOP target since he was first elected 4 years ago. Now, recently, the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee canceled some advertising in the Green Bay market. So, is that a sign Kagen is in trouble, or is there more to it than that? Today, we're asking Congressman Steve Kagen, who joins us from our affiliate, WFRV-TV. Dr. Kagen, thanks very much for being with us today.
It's my pleasure. A very good morning to you and to your listeners.
Thanks for joining us. Let me begin by asking a very simple question. Senator Russ Feingold, in his bid for re-election, has often referred to himself as the underdog in the race. How do you view yourself in your race?
Well, I look at it this way. I'm a hard worker. I'm honest. I'm someone who can't be bought. So in this district, that's a pretty good moniker to have.
I do want to spend just a moment on the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee's decision not to do certain advertising in Green Bay. It's a recent decision, and I've heard their explanation for that. But in a race where every dollar counts, a contested race, isn't it a bit disappointing?
Well, not at all. We have the necessary resources to deliver our message, to begin to alert every voter in the district about how important this race is. You know, it's been said almost in every election that this is the most important election of our time. The difference is this time it really is, because this election will determine whether or not we fall backwards into the economic ditch following the same policies that got us into this great recession. So we're going to make it. We're going to move forward following policies that are fiscally responsible and socially progressive. I think we have the necessary resources to deliver our positive message.
Let's talk for a moment about your record. You've taken some heat for a few of your votes, whether it was for cap and trade or the stimulus package or health care reform, votes which you still defend today. Do you think those votes, supporting those measures, represented the will of the people in your district?
Oh, absolutely. Look, I practiced medicine as a small business owner here for 25 years in my hometown of Appleton and in Green Bay, so thousands of people know me as their doctor. And in my medical practice, time and time again, insurance companies were disqualifying my patients because of pre-existing conditions. They were discriminating against people who are citizens of this country only because of the way they were born or because of an ailment or an accident that they did, that they had through no fault of their own. So when I was elected because of my theme that no patient should be left behind. So I'm very proud to say that Northeast Wisconsin had a great deal to say in our health care debate and in our new health security law that guarantees no longer will any citizen suffer from discrimination against any pre-existing medical condition. No longer will an insurance company be allowed to cancel you just because you get sick. And no longer will a family be allowed to go broke just because their child has an accident or gets sick. So I'm very proud to say that I'm running on my record, my record of positive change, particularly in health care.
No regrets on the stimulus vote. You feel the stimulus package did what it was intended to do?
Well, doing nothing was not an option. If we had not acted and taken bold action, the unemployment rate would have shot up to 16 or 18%, according to almost every economist that's taken a look at it. So we have begun to stabilize our state government, begun to work our way out of the ditch. We now have 136,000 manufacturing jobs we didn't have before. So we're moving in the right direction. The last thing we want to do is go back to the losing policies that caused this economic crash in the first place.
Let's talk for a moment about Social Security, because you've been very critical of your opponent, Reid Ribble, on this front. You say that he wants to phase out Social Security, and that's something that you've said time and time again in political commercials up there. But my question is, what would you do to ensure the solvency of Social Security for future generations? And be specific. What are you talking about?
Well, Social Security is a real sacred trust between one generation and the next. And Social Security is on sound ground until 2037, at which time 78% of your benefits will be coming to you. So we do need to shore it up, and there's a good way to do that. Not by increasing the age at which you can qualify for the money you've already put in, not by making certain that your benefits are decreased in any way, but rather by taking a look at the earned income that is applicable towards Social Security. Right now it's about $106,800, and if we need to raise revenue in any case, first thing we have to do is take a look at that cap to decide if we should adjust it upwards slightly in a sufficient manner to take care of people who've already put their money in. The other way to shore up Social Security is to restore our economy, putting people back to work. When people are working, they're paying taxes, and then our economy will do better, as will Social Security.
So taking those two steps, you feel, would be enough to make sure that this program is solvent for generations to come?
I believe so, and I'm looking forward to the fiscal commission that's been put together. It's a bipartisan commission. They're going to have a report ready in December, and we'll take a look at what the actuaries have to say, and I'll be using my best judgment to make sure that Social Security never, ever goes away. I have committed myself to protecting Social Security against anyone who would seek to privatize it, personalize it, or otherwise, as my opponent has said he would, phase it out.
I have time for, really, I guess, just one more question. And it's a question that I asked of the Democratic National Committee Chair, Tim Kaine, when he was on this program a few weeks ago. And it goes something like this. You know, a lot of people out there, you know this, are frustrated. They're not happy about where the economy is today. In some cases, they're downright angry. And the Democrats are the party, your party, are the party in power. How do you overcome that in this election season where people are frustrated, where they are angry?
Well, that's a great question. I can tell you why people in Northeast Wisconsin are disappointed and angry. It's the same reason I'm angry. It's because everybody here in Northeast Wisconsin and Main Street across the country is being asked to pay for the mistakes of gamblers and speculators on Wall Street. We are suffering in our economy here in Wisconsin because of things we didn't do. We're being asked to pay for somebody else's mistakes. That's why they appreciate the fact that I voted no to bailouts and yes to jobs. I voted no on bailouts because in Wisconsin we don't reward people for their failures. So I think that people are angry and disappointed. They're disappointed that the economy hasn't come back as fast as we'd like it to, but we're headed in the right direction. It takes us about as long to get out of this mess as it took us to get in. We've got to work together, stop pointing fingers, and we're going to make it. We're going to make it in America by working together.
Congressman Steve Kagan, we appreciate your time today. Thanks very much for being with us on Upfront.
Thank you.
And next, the Republican businessman challenging Steve Kagan. Why Reid Ribble says the 8th District is ready to turn red. That's when Upfront continues.
Upfront with Mike Gousha, brought to you by American Transmission Company and the Wisconsin Corn Growers Association.